Let us pray. Father, we are so thankful that we have this opportunity tonight to worship you and learn more about you and the things you do for us in our lives. And we pray that you will be with us as we continue to go through this difficult time that we're in right now. And we pray that things will be better. And we pray that you will be with our leaders of this country that are making the decisions that affect us all. We pray that you'll give them wisdom to make those decisions. Be with our nation as we're in this chaotic period in our land, and people are doing things they shouldn't be doing. We pray that there will be a healing in this country and people's hearts and minds will be changed if they only look to you, Father, for the guidance that you give us, that you always give us. Be with our church family here and be with our elders and deacons, and that they make the right decision. Give them the wisdom. Be with Larry as he continues to bring us the lessons. And we're so thankful for what you do for us in our lives. In this prayer we ask in our son's name. Amen.
The ho-hum life of everyday Jesus, as we read through the scriptures, I would say seems probably more useful than the life in which we live, or maybe we feel that way sometimes. Today I want us to look at one specific happening in Jesus' life, because really when you think about it, there was nothing ho-hum about his life. There was a purpose by which he was sent, that he might seek and to save that which was lost. The event that I want to talk about today took several days in the making to come to fruition, but as we look to it, there's no doubt that a lot of good came from it, because Jesus was going to point at who he was. In John chapter 11 and verse 25, Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life, and he who believes in me will live even if he dies." Today we continue in our His Life study, and today we want to talk about Jesus as the resurrection and what it meant for him to be the resurrection and why that's important for us. And so the event I want to talk about today is the day in which Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Well, what brings us to the grave of Lazarus was just a small part of what Jesus experienced in his day-to-day living. It wasn't ho-hum. It wasn't just an everyday occurrence. You see, sometimes we experience our own friends becoming sick, and sometimes even because of a horrible illness or cancer, that person will die. Jesus was the same in that respect, that Lazarus, and who we're going to discuss here in just a few moments, was a friend of Jesus. Lazarus became sick, and Lazarus died. Lazarus had been in the grave for 4 days, and this was just another example of showing those that were around him, showing those people who Jesus was. Remember, the purpose of Jesus' miracle was to attest to his deity, but also to show people who he was in relation to the Son of God. And so this is another example of how Jesus is going to show this. Another happening during the time of Christ to strengthen the faith that those were around. Even though some would disagree and disbelieved in it, for the most part, as they saw these miracles that Christ was performing, attesting to his deity, people believed. So just imagine what it must have been like for the handicapped, or excuse me, the hand-picked 12, would say some were handicapped in not believing in Christ based upon their eternity. But when you think about the handpicked 12 of Jesus to be given these hard and fast reasons to believe because their ministry is unfolding before the eyes of Christ. They're learning how to go about this process. So in John 11 and verse 15, it says, "And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there that you may believe. Nevertheless, let's go to him." So Jesus wanted his disciples, his apostles to believe. Now he's going to use this miracle to make a proof positive test concerning who he was and what it meant for him to be Jesus. So one of the things we have to remember, believing was just part of our day and in that day in which we're going to walk with Christ here. That was just the premise, the first unpacking of this, so to speak. Belief was going to point them to Jesus, but also as he unfolded this miracle, was going to bring about their faith. In Hebrews 11 and verse 6, it says, "But without faith, it's impossible to believe him," or to please him, rather. "For he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him." Faith only was not the message that Jesus is trying to portray here. The Lord also taught that ones who would believe had to follow him. So faith was the first step in that process. Jesus called on his believers to follow him literally and figuratively. Jesus said in John 11 and verse 15, "Let us go to him." So Thomas on this occasion was up for the task. Notice John 11 and verse 16. "Then Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, 'Let us also go that we may die with him.'" So the following of Jesus seemed to be this commonplace for the handpicked 12, those that he would call his apostles. So faith wasn't just enough. They had to follow through with that faith and follow what he was going to do. But you had this other mark that determined that Jesus, or this other mark that Jesus must accomplish something, this other task. In Revelation 2:10, encouraged faithfulness even to the point of death. It's not just when we die, it's to the point that we must die for our faith or be willing to die for our faith. And this would include faithfulness in bringing or causing your own end. And so the death of Lazarus brings Jesus to Bethany. And so Lazarus' death would be the item that leads Jesus into teaching who the special I Am is. We've, over the last few weeks in our study of his life, addressed the I Am statements. Well, this is another statement that Jesus makes concerning the I Am when he says, "I am the resurrection and the life." And so when hearing that Jesus was near in John 11 and verse 20 tells us that Martha had gone out to meet him. She had left Mary and gone out to meet Jesus. And some of the first words that are recorded that Martha said to Jesus showed her faith. Notice John 11 and verse 21. "Now Martha said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.'" Lord, I know because of who you are, had you been here in that moment, he wouldn't be dead right now. You would have saved him. You would have taken care of him. But even more faith was shown in verse 22 when it says, "But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you, because you're Jesus the Christ, you're the Son of the living God." The same question that Jesus asked Peter in Matthew chapter 16, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, I am?" Martha addresses here, but you're the Son of God, and God will give you what you ask. I believe, I have faith in you. And so Jesus tells Martha that her brother is going to rise again. And so you can only imagine as Jesus said these words, I wonder sometimes, as it's not recorded for us, those that were standing on the perimeter watching this are going, "Yeah, right. Sure, you're going to do that. We know you've claimed and done these other miracles, so to speak, but to raise somebody from the dead, well, you know, that's really saying a lot." You have these so-called charlatans in the world who want to deceive people by claiming they can do miracles, though we understand those form of miracles are no longer accessible today, because we have his word, 1 Corinthians and verse chapter 13. But you have individuals who want to deceive folks and say, you know what, they've raised people from the dead in foreign countries, yet there never seems to be a witness nor a video recording of these things. I heard a preacher say one time concerning an individual who said that he could raise people from the dead, he said, "I'll tell you what, we'll go to the graveyard, we'll go to the cemetery, you tell them to stand up and I'll tell them to stay down. Let's see who wins that debate." We understand from this standpoint, Jesus was using this time as a teaching tool to point to him, that he was the life, and that those who believed in him would not die eternally or spiritually speaking. So This now brings us, as Jesus tells Martha that her brother's going to rise again, Jesus has immediate resurrection plans for Jesus. And this brings us to this very special I Am speech. And in the midst of Martha's great claim of faith, Jesus enlightens her. Now notice John 11 and verse 25 when Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Now, we're pointing to what he's about to do for Lazarus, but now Jesus points back to remember, I'm the resurrection in relation to who you're going to be to live eternally. I'm the resurrection and the life, and he who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. That's the hope and peace and comfort that we find in knowing that Jesus says, I am the resurrection because he died and was raised to walk as a new person just as we are, that he's this new individual because now he's sitting on the right hand of the throne of God. Martha then leaves and sends Mary to him. And so Mary shows her faith in almost the identical words of Martha. Notice John 11 and verse 32. And then when Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet saying, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. So Jesus asked, where's Lazarus laid? Martha took Jesus to the tomb and the multitudes followed him. You almost wonder if there was any whisperings going on behind the scenes. You really think this guy's going to do this? As some were also clamoring and saying, yes, he's going to do this. He's the Son of God. And so Mary takes him to the tomb. Multitudes follow him. And as with the other times in Jesus' life, there were those in the crowd who would applaud his sayings and actions. And again, as I said, others who were offering whisperings and who were doubting the claims of Christ. And when Jesus wept, the people were moved to comment on how much he loved Lazarus. These were those who would believe on him. Look how much he loved him. Notice John 11 and verse 37. And some said, could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind also kept this man from dying? There's your doubters. Well, if he opened the eyes of the blind, why didn't he keep him from dying? Why do we even have to go through this process? There was a method to everything that Jesus did concerning his teaching, the way in which he taught parables to help people believe and understand this idea of Christianity and who he was. So at the tomb, Jesus said, take away the stone in John 11 and verse 39. No doubt the crowd had doubts. And even Martha cried out, Lord, by this time there's going to be this great stench, John 11 and verse 39. It had been 4 days he's laying in this tomb. They didn't have the modern methods by which we have now to prepare bodies for funerals. You see, now there's this process that most bodies, once they go through the process of being prepared, can stay or last anywhere between 5 and 7 days. You didn't have those methods that we have now. So you can only imagine as this tomb was opened up and Lazarus had been laying in, we don't know exactly how hot it was, but as he's laying in this tomb for 4 days, there's going to be this stench. Jesus would place all three marks of faith, following and finishing, into one basket. So Jesus said to Martha in John 11 and verse 40, when Jesus said to her, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? Martha, where's your faith? She's concerned about the smell rather than about the situation that's about to unfold. They took away the stone. Jesus prayed to the Father in verse 43. Now, when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And when Lazarus came forth, everyone saw. I'm sure there was some astonishment. Perhaps even those doubters who had said if he had only been here, he wouldn't have died and we wouldn't have to do all of this. Can you imagine now as they could smell the stench of death within this tomb, as now Lazarus is going to be resurrected, now their belief is coming to fruition. Hey, maybe there is something to this Jesus. But Jesus said previously, as we stated, that we could go that they might believe on me. Again, this method of the process which Jesus is going through. So I'm sure there was this astonishment. Everyone saw that Jesus was the resurrection and the life. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection, I'm the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. I must believe in who Jesus is. You had the doubters, you had the naysayers, those that were standing off in the crowd, whispering behind the back of those that believe, saying, I don't really think this guy has what it takes. Sometimes the manner in which we walk our lives, we say the same thing about Christ. I don't think Jesus has what it takes. And so we put our faith in worldly things and we walk away from the glory of God. We can't do that. We can't doubt who Christ is. Maybe as we see the world unfolding now between situations happening and the trials and tribulations that our world seems to be suffering, it's easy for us to take our eyes away from the resurrection, the one who gives us life eternally. But that's what the devil wants us to do. He wants us to focus on the stench of death here rather than on the glory of God. Brethren, we can't do that. We've got to continue to focus on those things. And so when we think about Jesus as being the resurrection for us, the life, the one who gives us eternal life because of what he did, and proving himself time and time and time again to those that followed him, those that doubted, just as we discussed in our morning sermon this morning about those who doubted Paul when he placed Jesus alongside the scriptures to show Jesus in the Old Testament. You had those who were doubting, just as you had individuals in the crowd who were doubting here. We can't allow our faith to waver when the whispers begin to come. Put your faith in who God is and remember who the resurrection and life is. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Are you willing and ready to follow Christ today? Do you know that he's the resurrection as he makes this great I am statement? I'm the one who's going to give you eternity. Put your belief and faith in him today if you're not a Christian. Accept that gracious offer of salvation that God gives us based upon the sacrifice of his son Jesus. It starts with a belief in knowing what he did. You see, you had those who would not believe. You must believe that Jesus is who he says he is, that I'm the Son of God. First, it starts with repentance, something in which human beings struggle with because it means we have to change something. So I understand I have this mindset in knowing that I've got to change, but I've got to change my heart, the method by which I'm going to approach God and say, I want to be forgiven. God says, gladly, but tell me who Jesus is. As Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life, you have to believe that he is that he is the Son of God that died for you. And then you have to say, God, I want my sins to be washed away, to be forgiven, forgotten, the ephesos, the removal of, the remission of those sins, as Acts 2:38 says, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. So if you're ready to do that today, please reach out to us and contact us. You can find our information on our website at carycoc.org, or you can contact me or email me at minister@carycoc.org. If you're a child of God and you're struggling, you know who Jesus is. Maybe you've fallen out of love with Christ and you need to fall in love with him again. Remember everything that he went through that you might have eternity. And if you need to ask for forgiveness, bow your head and ask God to forgive you. God is willing and just to forgive you, and if we can pray for you, if we can help you in any way, please reach out to us. I'm so glad that you're able to be here this afternoon for our evening worship, and I certainly look forward to the day when I'm not preaching to empty pews and to a camera, but that we can be back together again as a family. If you're tuning in today and you're not part of our family here at Cary, we're so glad that you've chosen to be with us. And just know that we're glad that you've taken the opportunity to take time out of your day to worship with us, and I pray the richest blessings upon you. As always, I love you and I miss you. I look forward to the time when we can be back together, and I pray that you have a blessed week. God bless.
Eternity pleading on. Let us pray. Thank you, dear Lord, for this day you've given us to come and to worship you. We pray that the things we have done have been well-pleasing unto thee. Thank you for Larry and his family being with us. Please bless him with many years of faithful gospel preaching. Be with all of our elders, all of our deacons. Help us at this time that we are apart. Please bless each of our families and our congregation, Lord. Again, thank you for your son who came and died for us most of all, that we could have a home with you. Again, Lord, thank you for all those who have graduated. Please bless them. And may they always look to you for the answers that we need in this life, Lord. Thank you again for everything you've given us this day. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.